Indian country. What was Indian country? Some of the people who live in today's Indian country.
Our ancestors were forced here at gunpoint. And we are the remnants of that situation. And these land holdings are almost all we have left. So they become very important to us, not just in a physical, but in a spiritual and a cultural manner.
The conclusion I come to when I look at the maps and it says, we were clobbered. I mean, we had all this land, now we just got a little tiny bit and scraps, and we gotta use what we've got to come back.
We're getting cheated out of our money, we're getting cheated out of our land, and we have no say-so.
There's a picture of our reservation, and we only own 4%.
The law provides that the federal government can absolutely take Indian land at will without paying any compensation, without due process of law, for any reason whatsoever. Now, the federal government can't do that to anyone else in the United States, only an Indian tribe.
The plan always was to eliminate Indian tribes by one means or the other.
Hello, I'm Sam Donaldson. The people you've just seen and heard aren't actors. The thoughts they expressed reflect the results of hundreds of years of separation from the land they inhabited and wisely used for millennia, identifying themselves with the land as one and the same, from the natural canyons of the American West to the man-made canyons of Manhattan, they are real people. As inhabitants of this hemisphere for tens of thousands of years, the almost countless and ongoing tragedies and injustices of their post-Columbus history have been thoroughly documented for decades. Or have they? Today's American Indians feel they haven't, and because of it want you to know more of what really happened, and because of it how it's affecting their lives now, especially as it applies to their dwindling lands in the early years of the 21st century. What you'll see and hear during this program has its origins in 120 years of federal legislation and policy that is difficult to understand. But it's up to all of us to try and understand this history, as what happens to one of us in this democracy may happen to any of us. What you'll see and hear may surprise you. It may even anger you. But hopefully it will leave you with a new awareness and understanding about what today's American Indian population is doing to try to reverse the damaging results of numerous and sometimes insensitive legislative decisions. Historically, many non-Indians have characterized those decisions as mistakes of the past which couldn't matter today. That characterization has proven to be, in most cases, incorrect. Some of those mistakes were occasionally identified to be well-meaning. But most were more politically motivated, unjust travesties negatively affecting the lives of most of today's American Indians to the point of denying them the right to own, live, and work on reservation lands originally guaranteed through treaties and executive orders for their exclusive use. The challenges of this history have been both to their land and to their very survival as Indian people. During this program, we'll learn and witness more about those until now little-known legislative decisions wrought on an unsuspecting American Indian society. Today's American Indians are trying to deal with undoing those decisions, either purposely or arbitrarily made for them in the latter part of the 19th century and throughout the 20th century. Everything you'll see and hear is true, and a testament to why today's American Indians are intent on reversing the course. The music and the romanticized visions it conjures are both powerful and familiar. The music, of course, is a portion of Czech-born composer Antonín Dvořák's New World Symphony. And the vision of buffalo roaming the Great Plains matches the majesty of the music to the thriving culture the original people of this hemisphere enjoyed. Dvořák composed most of the New World Symphony in a New York City hotel room after visiting friends in the town of Spillville, Iowa. Spillville is the farthest west Dvořák ever traveled in the New World. But he claimed the impact of his love for the land's original inhabitants inspired him to compose his classic symphony as a romanticized tribute to American Indians and their vast but vanishing world. Inspiration to compose memorable music about American Indian-oriented culture wasn't limited to Antonín Dvořák. British-born composer John Barry's powerful score for the film Dances with Wolves stirred not only audiences, but also Barry himself, as he had never visited Indian country, but was inspired enough to know how to make us feel its energy and majesty.
It's a certain Western mode. I don't think this is very typical Western, quite frankly. There are some things in it that do smell of that, but that I don't think it's typical. I'd like to go down and take a look at Dakota now, having seen it on film. It looks wonderful.
The illustrations of how the original peoples of this hemisphere inspired non-American Indian artists and artisans to create what they did in romanticized tribute to American Indians are legion. From the music we just heard and the scenes we just saw, to the historic paintings of Montana's Charles M. Charlie Russell, to the tributes of noted authors and feature writers. Some might say the American Indians, at least the romanticized versions, are held in very high esteem by most people who are non-native. The artistic tributes, both romantic and idealistic, would appear to verify that thinking. There's no question regarding most non-Indians' admiration for the indigenous peoples of North America, and indeed this hemisphere. But unfortunately, all the admiration and creative tributes have done little, if anything, to undo or even recognize the injustices foisted upon them. Relatively few non-Indians have taken the time to really explore any more than surface knowledge about the past or current lives of American Indians, many of whom face daily struggles for mere survival. How did it happen? How could it happen? And when were the legislative mistakes that created the present-day survival anxieties for American Indians enacted and approved by Congress? Perhaps one way to emphasize the magnitude of what happened is to state this parallel. The day after Pearl Harbor was bombed, President Franklin Roosevelt declared that Sunday, December 7, 1941, was a date that would live in infamy. If there was another date that would live in infamy for the indigenous people of this country, it was February 8th, 1887.
The General Allotment Act.
The Dawes Act or the General Allotment Act.
The Dawes Act.
The Dawes Act.
The Dawes Act.
The Dawes Act. They call it the mighty pulverizing engine to break up the tribal mass, Teddy Roosevelt.
The United States government has been trying unsuccessfully to register American Indians for well over 100 years. The infamous Dawes Act of 1887 was the first such effort on a large scale. The purported aim of the act was to protect American Indian property rights during the Oklahoma land rush and to aid in the conversion of American Indians on other reservations to become farmers and landowners in the style of non-Indians. By registering, Indians were told, they would be allotted 160 acres of land per family in advance of the land rush, and thus be restituted for 100 years of genocide against them.
I'd consider the Dawes Act, or the General Allotment Act, as it was known when it was passed in 1877, as one of the worst pieces of legislation. It certainly wasn't the start of the impacts and the diminishment of Indian land ownership. It came about in the middle. Before that, there had been treaties which were as opposed to treaties as people often think of them, treaties were really instruments of land acquisition by the United States. They had a huge impact. But the Dawes Act, with its plan for conveying land individually to Indian people, had a number of significant flaws. From the federal government standpoint, it was designed to do a couple of things. One was to break up tribal land ownership, which it did. The other was to attempt to assimilate Indian people into kind of the then American way of life by making them farmers and ranchers. And in that regard, it failed pretty miserably.
Tribal members who held these allotments, they were, I think the intention was to turn them into farmers, you know, dry land farmers. So they were actually given plows and oxen and, you know, the implements for farming. You know, every family got those. And they even sent out Bureau of Indian Affairs people who were called boss farmers who tried to teach all the Indians how to farm, you know. And, you know, it didn't quite get a good hold. You know, needless to say, culturally, you know, traditional culture in pre-reservation time was, of course, mostly gathering, hunting economy. And the land was held in common for that purpose, you know, so that it would be easier for tribal members to gather food and to hunt for survival. And basically that was the cultural makeup of the, at least particularly in this area, the Rosebud Sioux tribe. You know, that's what they were doing, you know, at the time that all this took place. So when they allotted out these 160 acres apiece to the individual tribal members and they were to stay in one place, you know, live in that one place and then become farmers, well, that was quite a cultural shock to tribal members.
We used to be nomadic, so we would go along the plains summertime. We'd be down in the valleys, next to the mountains so that we could hunt and live there where it was cool. Winter times we came down into the valleys and so that we camped near the water so that it wouldn't be so hard.
The Allotment Act also provided that the land could be leased to non-Indians, and that's who was taking the land, that's where the land was going, or it could be sold. And that's how we get this checkerboarded pattern on these reservations.
The purpose of the Dawes Act, ostensibly to protect Indian welfare, was viewed suspiciously by many Indians, hurt by the government's clumsy past relocation efforts. Indians who had refused to submit to previous relocations refused to register in the Dawes rolls for fear they would be caught and punished. One of those who knows the story from a personal perspective is Robert T. Coulter.
What I think a lot of Americans don't understand is that the whole legal framework about Indian tribes and about Indian land in the United States is very, very flawed. You wouldn't like it and you wouldn't believe it if I told you. The law provides that the federal government can absolutely take Indian land at will without paying any compensation, without due process of law, for any reason whatsoever. Now, the federal government can't do that to anyone else in the United States, only an Indian tribe. My grandmother and her two sisters and their mother each took allotments in Oklahoma. Their father died in the process of moving, but my grandmother married a non-Indian man who promptly sold her allotment and disappeared. This was more or less normal. And so she ended up marrying again, which was a difficult thing, and settling on one of her sister's allotments where she lived out her days. And that allotment is still in our family. But her other sister, Lucina, had an allotment which she too lost, and the remnant of her life there is just a rose bush.
The type of loss experienced by Coulter's family was facilitated by the passage of the Burke Act in 1906. Again, Tim Coulter.
A more bureaucratic thing. The Burke Act is another one of those many acts of Congress that related to Indian allotments. It provided that the federal government could give to Indians a fee patent to the land they were allotted. The allotment system, as we know, provided for parceling up Indian reservation land and giving individual parcels to individual Indians and individual Indian families. Ordinarily, these parcels were protected for a period of 25 years or more so that they could not be swindled away from the Indian owner, so that the Indian owner wouldn't lose it through taxation or through debt or through sharp dealing of some kind. But the Burke Act permitted federal officials to issue clear title to the Indian owners so that the parcels would be taxed by the state and local authorities, so that they could be seized for non-payment of debt, and so that they could be swindled away or defrauded away from the Indian owners. The worst part was that this was done often secretly without the Indian owners even knowing it. The Indian owners would find out that they had an unprotected title only after they had lost their land. They would find that they no longer had title because it was seized for non-payment of taxes. Well, in many cases, those Indian owners never knew that taxes were owing. They never knew that their title was taxable. They never knew that they could lose their title.
The Burke Act also grants the Secretary of the Interior express authority over determining the legal heirs of deceased Indians for the first time.
The absence, if you will, of any effort for estate planning or the use of wills in Indian country comes from several sources, I think. One of those is, in some instances, a cultural obstacle. There are many individuals and tribes who don't like to talk about death or aspects of death or the ramifications of death. And so that inhibits their participation in the estate planning process. One of the other factors is the fact that the entire will function for trust lands and trust assets has been a function of the Bureau of Indian Affairs since the 1930s. And the Bureau of Indian Affairs has been the source of wills for Indian people, although their only function is dealing with trust property, either trust real property or individual Indian money accounts. They do that to a certain degree. It's not a service they tout. And of course, if an Indian person has non-trust assets, those don't get addressed in the BIA process. Thirdly, Indian people haven't had traditionally access to legal services or legal advice about estate planning.
My mother had a land allotment here on Leech Lake, and she passed in August of 1955. And since that time, there was no activity or no one actually knew of the land allotment until 1999. This was a surprise to all of my brothers and sisters because this basically was about 49 years after she had passed. Subsequently, in talking with the Bureau, the only real reason that they thought they couldn't and hadn't done anything on the probate was that they weren't able to find anyone. That was kind of an irony because our family has been living here on Leech Lake, though some of us have left and had careers and done other things. At least two or three of my brothers or sisters have been physically here on Leech Lake. So I couldn't find that as a viable excuse as to why it took 49 years for them to finally probate my mother's will. the travesty, I think, and the challenge that it brought to us children was the fact that we have lived the majority of our life unaware of this land allotment. Through this process, the fractionalization of this land and the way the law is written added numerous other children, you know, to the fractionalization, and so, you know, they're diminishing, you know, the amount of land that any one of us would have access to, and therefore the rule as far as being able to occupy and build on it, you know, we now have layers of other children and relations that have never lived on Leech Lake, have never been here, in order to get their okay to even reside or try to build anything on it. So, you know, it has put a lot of barriers in the way of us trying to, you know, feel that we have ownership to anything other than, you know, a piece of land that we're never going to be able to do honestly anything with.
My dad died a couple of years ago and handed all of his belongings to my mother. Part of that was portions of a land that he had received from his brother more than 30 years ago. We've been paying taxes on that land for 30 years when we found out a couple of years ago that the land has always been in trust and was never taken out of trust. So we've paid for 30 years of taxes on this land in Creek County, Oklahoma. We've got no hope of getting that land back. The Bureau never even knew that my uncle had died 30 years ago. And within the last, recently I should say, they probated his will 30 years late. The question we still have is, do we get our 30 years of taxes back? For the last 2.5 years, my mother has been trying to resolve the whole issue before she dies. And what happens? She talks to the county. The county says, go to the Bureau. Bureau says, we don't handle that, go to the tribe. Tribe says, go to the county. And it's all back and forth again.
You have probates that take too long. And when that happens, then who is the owner of that title? And I want to also say that the BIA has also done a lousy job of finding who those heirs are. Right now, today, there are just under 50,000 individual Indian landowners that the BIA lists under a title called Addresses Unknown. In other words, we may have tribal members living in California, but so they just put them on Addresses Unknown. So how many dollars does that equate to for 50,000 Indian Addresses Unknown?
The problem exists all over the United States and Indian country, but it differs from reservation to reservation depending on whether state law applies to the probate of Indian estates and whether or not the interests in land are owned by tribal members who live on that reservation and who are members of that tribe, or Indian people who are tribal members but not members of that particular tribe on which the parcel of land is located on that tribe's reservation.
The abuses of the Dawes Act were revealed and set forth in the Miriam Report of 1928. This followed by 4 years the not commonly known fact that it was only in 1924 that the U.S. Congress generously extended citizenship to all American Indians, a privilege they had never enjoyed up to that point. In the Miriam Report of 1928, a group of 1,001 American Indians and prominent citizens were charged by Congress to look into widespread allegations of corruption and abuse of the Dawes Act. The 800-page report documented massive fraud and misappropriation by the very government agents sent to administer the act. It was found that Indian-held land, which totaled 138 million acres in 1887, at the time the Dawes Act was signed into law, had been reduced to 47 million acres of land by 1934, when the act was repealed.
In the Dawes Allotment Act of 1887, and again, that reduced the land base for the tribes. For Umatilla, it was now down to 158,000 acres. From that 245,000. All the land that was not allotted was declared surplus. and was taken over by the government and auctioned off. So that left the tribes almost destitute because of that tremendous loss of land. And as time went on, like when you get into the 1940s, almost half of your reservation is gone. Almost half of that allotted reservation is gone into non-Indian ownership. and the only thing that really came along to help the Indians was the what they call the Indian Reorganization Act, the IRA in 1934. And that stopped the allotments, but it also gave the tribes an opportunity to get back some of the tribal land.
The Miriam Report of 1928 led to the passage of the Indian Reorganization Act of 1934, which stopped the allotment process of the Dawes Act. Although repealing provisions of the Dawes Act did not mean that land obtained through fraud was restored, the Indian Reorganization Act carried language that provided for the restoration of the Indian land base. So what happened to these provisions?
The Indian Reorganization Act passed in 1934. It is the act of Congress that ended the allotment policy. It's viewed as one of the most favorable acts ever passed by Congress in terms of Indian tribes. It's the act that contained the authorization for appropriations for the Secretary to acquire additional lands for Indian people. There have been provisions in federal statutes since 1934 that authorized the purchase by the Secretary of Interior of lands for tribes. To my knowledge, that has never been funded. There's an appropriation authorized of $1 million, which in 1934 probably was a significant amount, but I don't think there were ever, since that time, funds appropriated for that.
The Congressional Record on November 7, 2000, noted the downsizing of the Indian land base through federal legislation and policies. Among other findings in regard to the Allotment Acts and related federal policies, the official record states, over 90 million acres of land have passed from tribal ownership, many trust allotments taken out of trust status, often without their owner's consent. In addition, the document continues to address blatant exploitation via land sales that resulted in no benefits for the original landowners.
Secretarial transfer is those lands that were sold by the Bureau of Indian Affairs without 100% consent of all the owners of an allotment. So, and there are other claims such as the tax forfeiture, there is forest fee, there's trespass, but the only records that we have are the secretarial transfers. So that is just those claims that they sold without 100% consent of the owners.
My grandmother, like I said, was 6 months old when she was allotted this land, and the government had given out or authorized certain attorneys to go out and look over the interest of these individuals. As she got older, we found records to where her land was given away without her knowledge.
Tribes were asked to identify and give to the Bureau of Indian Affairs a list of all of the claims that they could identify that they would have, and then individual tribal members were given the same opportunity. I reviewed those that were developed on behalf of the Nez Perce tribe and Nez Perce tribal individuals. And on behalf of individuals, there were several hundred claims just identified as forced fee patent claims. And this, of course, would have happened to people living today, their grandparents, if not great-grandparents, would have happened probably around the turn of the century. But that process and the loss of the land to state taxation is a burningly vivid memory in the minds of people whose families were affected by it, who were dispossessed of what they view as their family lands. I suspect any number of people today can recite the individual stories that they have of the allotment and the allotment number and where it was located, where it is, and then the loss of that land to their family.
Those situations where the patents were held, that is, where the allotments were held in fee, where a fee patent had been issued, that presents a whole other issue. Retribalizing that land is a very different thing. Most of it's been lost. The allotment that we still own is one of the very few Potawatomi allotments that's still in Potawatomi hands. There are almost none left.
While the outright loss of reservation land as a result of the Dawes and Burke Acts was the most readily apparent problem, a more insidious issue was the system of inheritance of trust land established by the two acts. It was decided that the land allotments held in trust by the federal government would not be physically divided when the owners' estates were probated. Rather, the title to the land would be divided among the heirs, but physically held in common. This resulted in what is commonly referred to as fractionation or fractionated titles. It wasn't until 1983 that Congress passed the Indian Land Consolidation Act to try and address the ever-growing amount of fractionation of land titles in Indian country.
The Indian Land Consolidation Act, when it was first passed, was meant to address this high fractionation for Indian allotments. The House Resource Committee passed out Senate Bill 1721, and that bill is amending the Indian Land Consolidation Act with the addition of an Indian Probate Act, Indian Probate Reform portion to the Indian Land Consolidation Act. And the standards, there has never been a standardized, uniform probate code at the federal level that all tribes would go by. So the administrative law judges, as they would handle this internally, had state law that they would go by, and the probates again began to be backlogged, and tracking those individual heirs was a nightmare.
The purpose of the current amendments is to eliminate fractional interest in trust lands and encourage the consolidation of tribal land holdings. Among its provisions, ILCA creates inheritance schemes, complex rules about who can inherit what when an American Indian landowner passes away. For those who die without a will, the amendments restrict the benefits of interest held in trust that non-Indians can inherit, authorize adoption of land consolidation plans, authorize development of tribal codes involving descent and distribution of trust or restricted lands, and provide for escheat to tribes of certain fractionized interest.
What you're just looking at is a title status report. These are prepared by the Bureau of Indian Affairs Titles and Records Office out of Aberdeen, South Dakota. This is the same as an abstract of title that you would have on land off of the reservation. This is on Standing Rock Allotment 299. Standing Rock Reservation is in North and South Dakota, in Sioux County, North Dakota, and Corson County, South Dakota. This tract of land is 320 acres. And it has 944 owners on it. The tribe is the largest landowner on here. They own 27%. And the only reason they got in there is they've been acquiring these small undivided interests for many, many years. There are 943 other owners on this piece of land. Now, in the old days, before we had automation to pay out our the lease money and everything on this, we would only pay it out once every 10 years because we wanted to ensure that everybody gets a penny on this thing, at least. Nowadays, with automation, many of these people don't get any money at all, just the largest share owners. This report itself is 83 pages long. If you uncurled it here and put it out there, it's 76 feet long altogether. The person that owns the smallest share on here is 1/79,380,000. And he owns it in common with everybody. He can't just say that this is my spot here that I own. He owns it in common in the whole 320 acres. That share comes out to approximately a 5-inch by 5-inch square. Individual owners and families owning small shares like this really can't take advantage of anything. They can't go and put a house on a 5-inch by 5-inch square. This individual's family, there's three of them in that family, three siblings, comes out to 3 5-inch by 5-inch squares in common with everybody else. Obviously, you can't put a house on it. You can't even stand on that. There's no way that they're going to be able to go to a bank, get a mortgage on this property, and get a loan to build a house someplace. Many people, most of the people that own land on Standing Rock, own many, many shares like this, small shares. Some of them come up to quite a few acres where they would be able to utilize those if they were able to consolidate them someplace. Most of them are smaller shares. They won't be able to consolidate them, and they get a few dollars lease rental every year off of it, and that's about all they can do, really. That it's doesn't help them that much. You know, even though you look at a piece of paper and say, well, I own 200 acres, you might have 200 little tracts of land here and there, little shares like this, or, you know, 400. It could be just about any number. Most of these people aren't even from Standing Rock. The majority of them are from other reservations. As managers of the trust assets here, when we try to lease this property out, if we have to contact all of the owners on there to get their permission, or even a majority of them, sometimes there's hundreds of letters that go out trying to get the permission of the owners to get a lease contract on it, to get a right-of-way, to when we get the money in here, to break it down to all these individuals and get it paid out to them in a timely manner. If an individual comes in and wants to consolidate all the property for a piece of land that they can use, we have to get appraisals on these properties, land descriptions, we have to prepare deeds. It's a long, drawn-out process for anybody to even do that.
I think it's fundamentally important for American people to really keep in mind that, not unlike with the dollars in the individual Indian money accounts, that's Indian money. Similarly, with land assets, that's Indian land. It was guaranteed to them. And it's a matter of having individuals own and manage and control their assets. And that's a freedom that all American people enjoy. And in fact, it's a basic premise among certainly the Republican Party of this country, and a conservative agenda piece. And so it's difficult for us to understand how people would say to us, well, this is a very liberal cause. Well, it's not necessarily a liberal cause. It's very much a fundamental right of people to control their assets. And that's what we want to get across to the American people, is that this is about Indian people controlling their own assets.
This began in 1965. My cousin and my two cousins and I, we were getting oil royalty checks from the Bureau. And before then, we used to get like $1,000 to maybe $1,200 a month. And then it started slowly going down to where it was like maybe $100 or $150 a month. So they came to my house one day, and we started coming to Anadarko, and we started questioning why our checks were going down a lot, you know, a lot more than $1,000 to $150. And we were given the runaround at the Bureau. We were sent here and we were sent there, and finally, we got to talk to one individual. He's deceased now. But we went in there, we asked him, we said, we're really experiencing some hardships, and we'd like to know when we're going to get our check. And he said, well, he said, I really can't tell you when, he said, but it should be coming soon. And I said, can we come around and talk to you by your desk? And he said, well, come on around. So we did. We went around there, and we began to ask him questions. And I looked down, and there was our checks sitting there. They were not mailed to us. They were just sitting there. And I said, how long has this check been here? And he said, oh, about a week.
As a general matter, ILCA restricts the inheritance of trust property to Indian persons only, regardless of whether or not the decedent left a will. However, there are some important differences in the circumstances of individuals who leave wills and those who do not. Under ILCA, a person is Indian if they fulfill one of three qualifiers. One, he or she is a member of a federally recognized tribe. Two, he or she is eligible for membership in a tribe. Or three, he or she is found to meet the definition of American Indian under provision of federal law if the secretary arbitrarily determines using such a definition is consistent with ILCA's purpose. An element of individual or tribal legitimacy leading to rightful land ownership, and which can't be overemphasized, is that all land claim problems begin with the certification process. Either federal recognition of the tribe or documentation of tribal membership for each landowner. That process has become a logistical nightmare for American Indians who simply want to own a home.
The Bureau of Indian Affairs has dealt with the fractionation problem since the initiation of the Allotment Act in the late 1800s. What fractionation is defined as is the fractionation of the land title. There are various landowners involved from the original allottee. At one time, there was one owner to a specific tract of land. Subsequently, the death of that landowner, which fractionated to the children, to the spouse and the children, to nieces, nephews, to parents, to aunts and uncles, each situation was different. We actually have original allottees still living, one landowner. And then on the other scenario, we have tracts of land, as we call it, owned by up to 1,200 people. Their ownership interests vary. The problems that generates are wide and varied. We've dealt with every scenario from non-Indian spouses to non-enrolled children to tribal members that we can't locate that are beneficiaries, that are heirs, as we call them, to these ownership interests or these entire tracts of land. The Bureau of Indian Affairs maintains the title records on all of these allotments and the subsequent ownership. There are millions of acres of allotments throughout the Bureau of Indian Affairs on various reservations. The challenge of administering, maintaining, utilizing, including the landowner or landowners, are as wide and varied as you can find the variety of Indian people.
We have won in U.S. District Court in Washington, D.C. every step of the way.
Her name is Eloise Cobell, and in future history books, her name may become justifiably synonymous with those of Joan of Arc or Rosa Parks. Each of those individual women, regardless of the personal consequences, decided enough was enough, faced their challenges firmly and decisively.
The problems that we have right now is to make sure that Congress is aware and is educated to understand that the money that are in these individual Indian accounts is our money. It's not appropriated money. It's our money. And so when they start pushing Enron to do the proper thing, laws are passed to make sure that Enron doesn't happen again, then they've got to think about us. The individual Indian trust accounts, which that they are responsible for and liable for to Indian people. So I think we have a lot of more educating to do in the Congress to make sure that acts are not passed, midnight riders, that doesn't happen again to us. It has happened in the past where the administration ran to Congress and got, in the wee hours of the night, got a midnight rider approved that would stay the accounting for a year. We won the accounting, and we won the accounting by the U.S. District Court. We won it by the appellate court, and the government did not appeal to the Supreme Court, so it's the law. It's the law that they have to give an accounting. But they ran to Congress, and a midnight rider was approved, and so they stayed it for a year. So we've got to make sure that everybody in the United States understands that our case is an ongoing court case and that we should not have interference from Congress. I feel that's totally unconstitutional and unheard of in this country. But when it comes to the American Indian, the United States government can do absolutely anything, and they don't have to abide by laws. That's very disturbing to me all the way through this case, as the plaintiffs have won, but the administration has done everything in its power not to abide by the laws.
Ms. Cobell's decision to challenge the United States government via the Cobell versus Norton class action lawsuit filed on June 10, 1996 in U.S. District Court in Washington, D.C., was initiated to force the federal government to account for billions of dollars, $137 billion by actual count, owed to approximately 500,000 American Indians and their heirs, supposedly held in trust for payment to them since the late 19th century, but never paid.
This country should never allow this case to go to the Supreme Court. Number one, we should have never even had to file this lawsuit. This lawsuit should not have ever been allowed to happen by the three branches of government, because it was a breach of trust by the United States government.
The lawsuit, which is making 21st century history, is one for which Ms. Cobell has accumulated many champions.
The Cobell litigation, of course, is on the accounting of all of the IM accounts, and it's a lawsuit by Eloise Cobell, the lead plaintiff. That was filed in 1996 versus the United States Secretary of Interior to do an accounting for, and we know that there are billions. We're not talking hundreds of dollars. We're talking billions of dollars that were mismanaged. They can't account for it, and they don't want to pay for it.
What we see as a result of Eloise Cobell's magnificent major turn as a result of the lawsuit is that these problems that have been out there for years are now, through court order and court mandate, being addressed by the Department of the Interior. There is a problem. They are understanding that fractionation has to be dealt with. The backlogged probates are, I understand it, about 23,000 backlogged probates. Those will also generate new probates before the backlog of 23,000 interests will be addressed. I've heard Eloise Cobell. So do we treat brown people's money differently? Do we treat the income from the leases differently? And obviously, in law and legally, the answer is no. There is ultimately the most incredible amount of justice that's waiting there for Native Americans.
The recent behavior of the government in the Indian trust funds cases exemplifies this, a flat-out refusal to account for that money, a flat-out refusal to abide by the law in handling Indian property and money.
The Cobell versus Norton case gave a certain momentum to Indian country to redress the transgressions of the federal government in terms of trust management, and that trust really started with the land.
Eloise Cobell's bold actions were made out of honest outrage and concern, not any desire for personal fame, or for that matter, personal gain, but rather to correct the outrageous legal and financial injustices and outright thievery of the dominant society's government, which not only broke almost all its promises, but whose actions also almost exterminated a race and left those still alive living in almost abject poverty.
The federal resources have been woefully inadequate to address the needs in Indian country. Notwithstanding the fact that the treaties that the United States entered into with Indian tribes in exchange for the cession of hundreds of millions of acres of land to the United States by the Indian tribes, in exchange for which the treaties promised in perpetuity a right to the provision of health care and education and other things that would support life in reservation communities. The United States side of that bargain has consistently been unfulfilled or inadequately fulfilled.
The Indian people have always been in poverty. They have always been, we've been neglected in our education, just like she said, like some of our colleges now, their budget has really went down to practically nothing. And the promise that they gave us a long time ago is that they would educate the Indian people and keep them in good health. In our health services, we don't get that good of a care. We don't.
The Anglo-Western European psychology has come on my people. The younger generation has lost respect for themselves.
To portray all U.S. legislators as uncaring and uninformed or even disinterested in regard to American Indian issues would, of course, be incorrect and unfair. But history has shown, via all too starkly real examples, that regarding American Indian land issues, the consensus is strongly stacked against their good judgment. The Eloise Cobell case opened up every element of government wrongdoing in regard to American Indian survival. One of those was the impact legislative decisions concerning land ownership have had on rural economies for both Indians and their non-Indian neighbors.
That's my land. That's my land they're getting money from. The agency don't even want to help us. They rent our land. They rent our pastures without even asking us. Now the farmers, they come in. They don't negotiate with us. They go to the agency, and they can get our land cheap.
Our main charge is to promote the Indian use of Indian resources. We dedicate a lot of time and effort in opening doors for tribes and individuals in the development of agriculture enterprises and to protect those resources as well. There's a great need today to take care of what we do have. Focus today is on income derived from the land and not necessarily taking care of the land. And I personally see a regression or a decline in the condition of the resources. They're being overutilized. And, you know, the Bureau of Indian Affairs does not have the ability to manage lands. The tribes rely on the Bureau's ability, and many tribes do not have, you know, the technical expertise at hand to assume that role. Some tribes are developing it, but as a whole, I think the greatest need today is ensuring that that land is preserved for future generations. And unless we start taking care of it, we're not going to have the land of any value to pass on.
What's good for the Indian nations in our region is good for the rest of the region and vice versa. A core group of people from two cultures work together on economic development. And the native culture is concerned about health because their life expectancy is 25 years less than the whites of the region. So we're sitting across the table talking about job development, and they're talking about diabetes and very real health issues, behavioral health, physical health, problems that lead to high rates of suicide and accidental death. And it does humble you. It says, this is happening right here in our region, and these people we're working with are facing the prospect of living 25 years less than we are. Really grounds your effort and tries to look at this aspect of community development within economic development.
What they call the Indian land claim settlement, and that was in the amount of maybe $2.5 million. Not very much, but it came, the tribe accepted that. And when we were making that decision of whether, how we should spend that $2.5 million, we didn't have any economy. We didn't employ anybody. We were destitute. If we wanted to work, we had to go off the res to do that. But now we pull over 1,000 people. But that's the great difference it makes when you have sovereignty, when you have control, when you have ownership. That's what can happen. But without that, you're just in a bad state. You're in a bad way.
While the Cobell lawsuit is possibly the most powerful in U.S. history, a less confrontational and possibly just as effective an approach could be a $20 million initiative intended to reduce poverty that has already brought incalculable benefits and raised awareness.
The Indian Land Tenure Foundation came from a three-year planning process within the Indian community that involved hundreds and hundreds of Indian people addressing Indian land tenure issues, including the ownership, the management, the control of Indian lands. And through that process, that three-year planning process, the community decided on a mission and four strategies that they wanted to pursue as a community. And part of that included putting together an entity that could, in fact, recruit resources and ultimately redistribute those resources into the community to, one, regain all of the land within Indian reservation boundaries, and then two significant areas outside of those boundaries that remain important to Indian people.
The Indian Land Tenure Foundation is providing support for many activities that support, directly or indirectly, the Indian ownership and control of Indian land. The foundation has developed a land curriculum for educational programs from Head Start through adults. They also support several estate planning efforts, such as the three-state program at the University of Idaho School of Law.
What we have undertaken with the Indian Estate Planning Project, as we're calling it, is an effort to offer those services to Indian people on Indian reservations throughout the three-state area of Washington, Oregon, and Idaho. And this project involves placing student externs from law schools within those states with legal services offices in those three states to travel out to reservations, make contact with Indian people and Indian organizations and tribal governments as well, to offer the opportunity to talk to individuals about estate planning and what it can mean, how it can help them, whether they need it. In some instances, that may not be something an individual needs. But if they do need assistance, actually sitting down with individuals and doing wills to make sure that Indian people have a chance to distribute their property as they see fit. And they're doing this for both trust and non-trust property. And whether an individual owns land or not, whether in trust or fee. So we view it as this is the first year it's been in operation. It is basically a pilot project. At this point in time, I can say it's been going very well. We have six people in the field doing work. They're all very busy, and I think we're going to find by the end of the summer, when they conclude their field work, that they've started having an impact in Indian country and letting people make decisions about where their property goes.
And there is no recourse when the Supreme Court of the United States declares that it's all right to steal Indian land. We've now got a formal decision by the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights that this constitutes a human rights violation. It's a denial of equality before the law. It's a denial of fair legal remedies. It's a denial of the right to own property.
For some tribes, the economic picture is not as bleak, thanks to the implementation of the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act of 1988. This congressional act stated that tribes who could reach compact agreements with the individual states in which the tribes were situated could open gambling casinos and keep all or most of the profits free from state taxation. Obviously, since Indian gaming has now become an accepted, mature, and successful enterprise in all states except Hawaii and Utah, a good number of those tribes who elected to participate in gaming opportunities have done fairly well. And a few have done very well and have had their economic standards of living elevated.
The development of gaming as an avenue of enterprise and revenue for Indian tribes, at least in my view, was one of the best things to ever happen. Most Indian gaming operations have a positive cash flow, but they're not gold mines as some of the huge ones are. In my experience for many years, a successful tribal business was one that didn't lose too much money, but that created jobs.
It's really significant in Indian country that we've been able to step up and put a shot in the arm to those economies, and again, through good jobs and good wages, not minimum wages, good wages. California is an example. Approximately 16% job growth in California in Indian gaming, where there's a declining economy.
In my tribe, as an example, wintertime unemployment rate amongst tribal members would go to 75%. Because the work is seasonal, and it's the kind of work that people can get. Stepping into that enterprise for the Nez Perce tribe, for the most part, solved the unemployment problem. If people wanted to work, they could get a job. The unemployment rate went down. The tribe employed, I'm not sure how many people individually the gaming operation employs, about one-third of them are non-Indians who work in the gaming operation. And the positive cash flow allows the tribe then to look forward and do some looking into other business ventures, because nobody believes that gaming is a forever thing. It's risky given the politics.
Not all American Indians have had the opportunity to live on land set aside for them by the federal government and eventually taken away. Many have chosen or been forced against their will or desire to live in urban areas, strictly as a matter of survival.
And most of us are here because, you know, they took the land, because there is no no place for us. And, you know, people came to the cities for education, for employment, and housing, decent housing.
In many cases, with no place else to go, many American Indians in the 20th century were forced to assimilate into the dominant society's lifestyle in order to survive. Now, many are returning to the reservation homelands, as casino revenues allow them to resume lives different than they might have imagined during pre-gaming years.
I think there have been many people that have moved back because there is increased employment, and you know, tribes are building houses all the time. And so there are people who are moving back, you know, to be with family, to participate in activities on the reservations because of casino gaming.
Nonetheless, the issue of urban American Indians as absentee landowners has been ongoing for decades and continues to be a source of concern and irritation for those who are living it.
Most of the time when people understand, like, that they're landowners is when an elder in the family dies. Anytime somebody in a family dies, there's a probate hearing and over the land, and it lists all the ancestors, the enrollment, and the portions of land that are owned by a particular family. What happens is most of the time that land, and as time goes by, the land becomes too small, or there are so many people who are owners of the land that the land then reverts back to the tribe and is held in trust. And so that's a good thing. But yes, many people do not understand, you know, our own history, because it was never taught to us. And so they don't know that, you know, all of the land that was at one time collectively held in trust was parceled out, you know, in 1887 to individual allotments. And so, you know, you see on reservations this checkerboard pattern. But many people don't even understand that they are owners of the land.
In one of the nation's most celebrated urban areas, Washington, D.C.'s new Museum of the American Indian, part of the sprawling Smithsonian Institution, is situated on the very last land available to the Smithsonian for construction purposes. It's ironic that now even those who wish to honor American Indian heritage have exhausted their land in order to do so. The heretofore almost unsolvable issues of American Indian land ownership and dilution of those lands had their genesis in the nation's capital. There are a growing number of legislators in the 21st century who want to help right the wrongs of the past from both sides of the congressional aisle.
Oh, it's probably the saddest chapter in our long history, and the exploitation of Native Americans continues today, and beginning with the Pilgrims providing the local Indian tribe with some blankets that were infested with smallpox, to today we are investigating a group of Americans who have exploited Native American tribes who are engaged in gaming for very large amounts of money, and I'm afraid that it will continue.
Well, I think that the treatment of our Native Americans is a national tragedy. Unfortunately, it's not a tragedy with an end. A lot of that tragedy continues today. It's a tragedy that has meant an embarrassment to this country, but far more importantly, a painful experience for millions of Americans who deserve better. We need to live up to the treaty obligations that we made a long time ago. Those treaty obligations require this government to commit to a health plan, an education plan, a housing plan, an economic plan, a recognition of the rightful ownership of land. None of those plans, none of that recognition has been followed through today.
We did sign solemn treaties that we would provide them with education and with health care. We've not done that. We have not fulfilled those obligations. And those of us who have been involved in Native American issues for a long time will continue to struggle to make sure that we at least in some semblance fulfill our treaty obligations. And I want to emphasize again, we signed treaties with Native American tribes in return for land. And those treaties were on a government-to-government relationship. And we have to treat them that way, and we have to honor those obligations.
I think Congress, by and large, has given a lot of this lip service. There are some real heroes in Congress who have recognized the importance of much of this. Senator Dana Noe is one of those heroes. We just don't have enough commitment here. They get the lip service, but they aren't getting the kind of attention, they're not getting the kind of real commitment that could make a big difference. Well, I think we need national leadership. I think both sides of the aisle, both parties, need to say, look, this is important. If ever we're going to overcome the sad legacy that has been left with regard to the treatment of Native American people, we've got to deal with the treaty obligations and recognize that we have that obligation today just as we did back then. It means better schools, it means a better health care system, it means a stronger economy, better housing, it means dealing with the difficult issues of trust reform. We've got a lot of very specific needs that have to be addressed if ever we're going to live up to our obligations.
Today, people, new members of who come to the Congress, tend to look at Indian country or often ask the question, why are we still providing programs and services to American Indians? Well, it is because of those treaties. The treaties are not only the highest law of the land, but they are contracts. They are as valid as any other contract that the United States enters into. And the Indian people performed their side of the contract. They kept their promises under the treaty. Sadly and unfortunately, the United States has not done so. And so those obligations continue. And many people do not understand that it is because of the pre-existing sovereignty of the Indian tribes who were here prior to the formation of the United States.
It's not the government and the Constitution. That's a good document. These kinds of things are real wonderful and in place. But it's the people.
As of late, there's a lot of Indian lawyers. There's a lot of Indian engineers. There's a lot of Indian senators that are coming up. People running for high offices in the government. We know what we're talking about. We learned your language. We've learned your words. One of our chiefs told us, with education, you're his equal. Without it, you're his victim. We're nobody's victim anymore.
I think there are a number of things that could be brought to bear in order to maintain the momentum that has started. It's really time to start looking at the federal relationship with the Indian tribes and making sure that there's a recognition of self-determination by the tribes and that sovereignty is more than just a word, that the tribes have the ability to be self-governed entities within this nation. And that's difficult for many non-Indians to fully comprehend and understand, but it's clear that Congress has the opportunity to strengthen that role that the tribes play in terms of their own governance and, in fact, their own self-determination. And that will be the next kind of point of direction, if you will, that the tribes will need to take is getting Congress to, in fact, allow for true self-determination and sovereignty.
Today, the tribal government, of course, in 1943, they set up TLE, Tribal Land Enterprise, and what's going on is Tribal Land Enterprise, over the past 61 years, has been purchasing all these allotted fractionated lands and increasing the tribal land base, and thereby providing opportunities for the tribe to do different things, you know, economic development, provide home sites for tribal members, you know, people who are without land, they're landless, are able to acquire a home site lease, anything from one lot in town within a block to something like 2.5 acres. They're able to get a home site lease from the tribe for 25 years with another 25-year option and to build a house on. And then, you know, of course, they will have a place to live. The rest of the land is leased out to tribal members, who are interested in starting agricultural operations, whether it's farming, ranching operation.
The work here we do at Santa Ynez University deals with land and natural resource planning and development. The primary driver for our work has been using technology, state-of-the-art technology, to address land issues. For instance, we deal here on the Rosebud Sioux Reservation in terms of education, trying to educate our tribal members, our leaders, by using technologies like geographic information systems, global positioning systems, and remote sensing. These tools are very important in terms of developing a point of contact for information about the land. Education is also part of our effort, where we want to teach and teach our students to use these tools to help make better decisions about their land and also create economic opportunities with these technologies. In that, we've also have a research focus. We want to look at developing new ways or new interfaces between science, data, and technology to the common native person. And in that, we feel that that's a strength that we have at the university in terms of our philosophy and how we look at using these tools to really empower our people with the correct information.
We have a cultural institute, we have a golf course, we have an RV park, we have a hotel, we have a casino, we have a truck auto service station that's there, and the streets and highways to provide transportation and services to those businesses. So in a short time, we have moved a great way.
It isn't any kind of contest or conflict with present-day landowners. It's more a matter of trying to find a way to see that our nation, our tribe, can have a good life and live in a situation of fairness and with a degree of decency and justice. We can probably do that.
I have a great deal of hope and drive that, in fact, Indian people will own this land again. It won't be in my lifetime. It won't be in the lifetime of my children. But perhaps my grandchildren will actually see a day when all of the land within reservation boundaries is owned by Indian people and managed and effectively managed by Indian people. And that gives me great hope. I think it's a hope that an awful lot of people in Indian country share and are driven to work on that.
At the beginning of this program, we stated what you'd see and hear might shock or disturb you, knowing what you would see and hear had never been addressed in a public forum such as this. Perhaps it did, perhaps it didn't. Indeed, if this program simply made you aware of what some people did or didn't do for the people whose land this was, all 4 billion acres of it, we'll consider it successful. It was apparent during all of the interviews for this program that there's a vitality and movement among American Indians of this century to honor their forefathers who signed the treaties by working to reverse the deleterious legislative decisions and federal Indian land policies and regain the homelands that were promised to them. I'm Sam Donaldson. Thank you for watching.